Can you imagine a world with no DJs? No radio, no top 20? That's what it was like once.
How did one DJ fill Brighton Beach with dance music? How did we get from this in the 1920s to this in the 21st century? What moves took place to jump from the jive to the high times in Ibiza? What quantum leap took place from the jukeboxes to the transistor radio to the MP3? The DJ's story is one of a passion for music, a revolution at 45 RPM from the high seas of the UK.
I was just trying to find something to listen to in the radio, and I found Radio Luxembourg. Let's go
to Oasis. From the grave, dude. Hey, hey.
Hey there, everybody. It's Monday night. This is your main man.
To the rock and roll radio game changers in the USA.
Come a long way.
Everywhere in Europe, dance music was really catching on.
It was the most amazing club I've ever been to.
You know, it was like going into Oz, you know, like the Wizard of Oz.
So we literally went from the 1,500 people to 6,000 people overnight.
All this and more to come in the history of DJ.
This is the BBC Life Show.
The Top 20!
It's the release!
Good evening.
Hi there. Welcome to the DMC Museum. Music's been around a real long time. It's been around maybe since we were cavemen. What a great gift music has been. But you know what? Radio hasn't been around that long at all. In actual fact, radio has only been on the planet for just over 100 years. That's not a very long time, is it? If you think about it. 100 years. What an incredible success story radio has had. Can you imagine a world with no DJs?
The time now is 11 o'clock British summer time, midnight Central European time. The makers of Stay Blonde and Brunatech shampoos bring you Europe's number one pop music program, Radio Luxembourg's Top 20.
No radio, no Top 20. That's what it was like once. There were no records to make a Top 20. They hadn't invented records, they hadn't invented record players or tape recorders. Music was something you went to see performed live. You saw it in parlours being played on pianos, in taverns by ceilidh bands with flutes and violins. And you saw it in music halls, like this one in Canterbury. This was in 1856. Yes, music was a live thing. We seem to have come full circle now, don't we? Can't make a lot of money out of records these days, so you make your money doing live gigs. Apart from paying a few live musicians, nobody could buy music, because nobody had invented anything that could carry music. Since the turn of the 19th century, composers such as Bach, Beethoven, Tchaikovsky, all those guys, relied on sheet music to carry their music around the world, and to make them a little bit of money too, one imagines. But all that changed the day the Italian genius Guglielmo Marconi perfected the sending and the receiving of radio waves across the Atlantic. It was 1901, and the times really were a-changing.
It's all very clever, really.
Oh. 100 years later, and it's quite amazing what DJs can do today as they move beyond the boundaries of mixing music and concentrate on the technical possibilities facing them in visual mixing.
Hey, enough showing off, Woody.
That'll do fine. Now, let's get on with the show.
Don't worry. I'm not getting into mixing and scratching. Before Marconi came a guy called Edison in 1877, who perfected the first recording device. And he actually recorded the first human voice.
Mary had a little lamb.
Used that particular nursery rhyme to demonstrate what was then called the tinfoil cylinder phonograph, which they called the graphophone. Now, for the very first time, sound was well and truly in the grooves.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
You really had to love music back in the day. Cranking up a 78 RPM record player with its huge speaker horn was dedicated work. The end product playback quality was pretty poor, really. But when you could transport an entire orchestra into your living room, who cared?
By the 20s, the American record industry had turned itself into a $50 million a year gross industry, directly attributable to Marconi's baby. But then by the Depression in 1932, the industry slumped to a mere $10 million a year. This wasn't just down to the Depression. This was blamed chiefly on radio, where music ran free like water from the tap. Doom and gloom was in the air everywhere, just like today with downloading and the internet, until along came the cavalry in the shape of a beautiful, round, shiny object that ran at 78 RPM. That's right, the 35 cent record had arrived.
You know what we thought of 78s, don't you? We were glad when the 45 came in, I can tell you.
And even better, we won't be needing this anymore because the electric record player has finally arrived. The world's first commercial jukebox was set up in San Francisco's Palais Royal Saloon in 1890. Jukeboxes not only survived through the Depression, they actually boomed. In December 1894, Marconi, at the age of 20, invented his spark transmitter with antenna at his home in Bologna, Italy. Taking this amazing black box through customs in the UK, the customs officers were a little suspicious and started breaking up the box. Marconi had said it was an implement that made sound travel through the air. About as crazy an idea as man's dreams to fly back then. In June 1896, the young Italian filed for British patent number 12039 and began to build an empire of Marconi companies. Here was the Bill Gates of his day and age, who invented radar long before cars were on the road. But the event Marconi will best be remembered for came 5 years later when he was resident in Great Britain, when in December 1901 he made his very first live broadcast from Cornwall to Newfoundland using balloons to take his antenna higher. Within 3 years, the British government made its move to control the medium with the introduction of the 1904 Telegraphy Act. From that day forth, everyone with a radio or a receiver had to have a license. The BBC was now on the horizon.
This is the BBC Light Programme. Here is the news.
Music wasn't a massive thing on radio just then. They were having lots of fun with plays. I remember this one, I wasn't there at the time, but I remember hearing about The War of the Worlds, the Orson Welles classic, which was put out as a play in New York and had people leaving the city because they thought it was actually happening.
Ladies and gentlemen, we interrupt our program of dance music to bring you a special bulletin from the Intercontinental Radio News.
In 1939, America's cafes and bars were housing 225,000 jukeboxes. The record industry had finally arrived. And so had the big bands and those massive halls where they used to go to watch theatrical acts and comedy. The tables were now moved away because people wanted to dance at last.
Slap that bass.
Slap those bass.
All right.
Swing it, Sasha.
Move your blue when you don't know where to go to. Why don't you go to Harlem? Let's pull on the wrist. Spangled down upon the belly of high ground. Down the levee, all this fits.
And the big bands were in charge. By 1941,
Germany calling.
Just as Lord Haw Haw was becoming Hitler's number one DJ with his Nazi propaganda, 127 million records a year were being sold in America alone. Gracie Fields Day had finally arrived.
Around the world I looked for you.
Do you have to go back to the influence of World War II on the BBC?
Of course.
Changed enormously because there had been only the home programme, and then they started a forces programme during the war, which was much lighter in its appeal. And out of that grew the light programme in 1946. So by then we'd got a situation where you had three, the home service, the light programme and the third programme. The third programme was very straight.
When you say very straight, classical music?
Yes, and serious drama, I believe.
Lord Reed.
Can I just say, I've got the impression that he was a bit of a dour man. He was brought up in a church environment and he imposed his own
desires for what he felt was a radio desire for the country. Is that about right?
Incredibly straight. It was called the British Broadcasting Company originally, I believe, when he first founded it. And he was the chairman and was a very strict disciplinarian, wouldn't tolerate any mucking about, nothing like the sort of things we hear about these days.
Absolutely,
you know?
Not.
Certainly not. You weren't even allowed to work there, I think, if you'd been divorced or anything like that.
He's probably turning over in his grave as we speak.
I'm sure. The concept was to have a public broadcasting organisation which wouldn't offend anybody. You've got to remember that it went unadulterated into everybody's home.
Yes.
There was no television in then, of course. It was just radio.
Was just developing.
And he had very, very strict standards of morality and about what could and what could not be happening. And on a Sunday in particular, you would have no frivolous programmes at all. I mean, there weren't many frivolous programmes anyway. He'd seen it as a very serious business.
Sunday was all religion.
Yeah.
All religion. And I think that handed the gauntlet over to Radio Luxembourg in
it
those
did,
days.
Welcome to the stand, the leader of England's finest orchestra, Johnny Dankworth, in his first American appearance.
How are you, Gary?
I'm fine.
Long time no see.
It sure is.
60s, in fact.
Yep.
Gary, what I want to know, first of all, is a little bit more about you. Who is Gary Brown?
Well, Gary Brown was a trombone player. I started professionally at 15 and a half, finished up with John Dankworth.
Wow.
I was with John for 6.5 years.
Everybody thinks the Beatles broke America, but it sounds to me like you're having a bit of an impact in the big band era as well.
59. According to the New York Sunday Times, they said this band is taking over from Basie and Ellington.
Yes.
Because at the Downbeat Pole, it used to be Ellington, Basie, then the next year it would be Basie, Ellington.
Yes.
And the Dankworth Band was third.
When I grew up, Tony, one of my huge interests was big band music. I suppose my earliest recollections when I was still at school, before I ever went into the Air Force, was going to the Coronation Ballroom at Ramsgate to see Ted Heath with Dickey Valentine, Lita Rosa and Dennis Lotus as the singers. And they were my idols. Can you imagine the thrill when years later I became a producer and they said, who do you want to book? And I said, can I book Ted Heath? Yes, if you've got the budget. So suddenly here was this man that I'd adored working for me, as it were, recording sessions for the BBC.
But I want to talk about the audience and the Birdland and all the dancing they did, you know, because that's where your career finally came, to the audience. It's down to how do we pack a dance hall? They come to dance. In the days you just talked about, they came to watch. And that's understandable because the music was incredible. But there was all kinds of dancing crazes going on, weren't there?
Oh, yeah, well, that came through because of the American troops.
Yeah.
That were over in England.
Yeah.
That's where the jitterbugging and all that really started.
I mean, that was like the big brother, if you like, of the jive, which became
well,
rock and roll
the jive,
when Bill Haley came along.
Well, Saturday night and I just got paid. Got the money, don't try to save.
I've been in the music business, I guess, from birth, but probably my most influential period when I first got into music was in 1957 when I first heard Bill Haley and the Comets and I went to see them. And I was 12 years of age. So then I had an interest in music. I collected music. I bought records. I collected records. I played in little bands when I was 15. I did talent shows when I was 16. I did working men's clubs when I was 16. And when I was 17, I decided this was too hard. So it was this start of the DJ. So I became a DJ.
As a great musician yourself, Gary, surrounded by other great musicians and living in that environment, what was the impact of Bill Haley on you? What did you all think of this blackboard jungle music, the rock around the clock theme and so on? Did you, a lot of people were repulsed by it. Did you feel repulsion?
Well, no, I didn't. I didn't as a musician. And I mean, I was at the other end of the spectrum with John. With,
yes,
you, know what I
you
mean?
Were.
It was a lot of people didn't like our music.
You mentioned about Johnny Dankworth broadcasting. So So that suggests to me the BBC were playing Johnny Dankworth and the big bands. I was under the impression, having read my history, the BBC were a bit reticent to bring big bands to the people.
Absolutely, and no more so because they had the plug list.
Luxembourg was the only pop station.
Yes,
it the was. Light programme was lovely because the Joe Loss Band, lovely Rusty Soul, and the Bob Miller Man. But Luxembourg, to plug a record, that was a station you had to get on.
You were working in the industry when sheet music publishing was...
No, it weren't that bad.
Wasn't it that bad?
No, not sheet music.
No, I thought you were actually...
The joke, sheet music. Sheet music, it wasn't that bad.
Yeah, no, we'll get it.
But you were working there right at the very beginning, before recording became a concept.
Well, no, I mean...
There was only really one radio station to plug in those days, wasn't there?
Well, the light programme.
Let's just go back to that broadcasting and that plug sheet. Yeah. I've got a vision now that the bands were told to play certain music by the publishers, not the BBC. So if you got Johnny Dankworth signed to your publishing company, you want him to broadcast that music so that you make royalties out of what he plays on the BBC. I can't see an instruction coming from the BBC itself telling the band leader what
to
play.
I don't know who started the plug list, but it was there, definitely there.
Yeah.
Radio Normandy, I think, was one of the other commercial stations that he started. There was a man there called Captain Plouge who ran it, and he used to do advertisements, and they became known as plugs. That's how the word plugger developed. Captain Plouge, who ran Radio Normandy.
Oh, goodness me.
But I think that went down at the beginning of World War II.
It was like a form of payola, really. Later on, Radio Luxembourg used to play records because they had publishing on the B-side.
Yes.
It's the same kind of philosophy, isn't it?
The publishers would send their pluggers along to watch the band, and they would put the number of fingers up for how much it was worth to get a play on a particular record.
Oh, my God, is that like payola?
Yeah.
Even at the BBC?
You had to play a certain percentage of the songs that the song pluggers were plugging.
Wasn't it so much payola, it was payment to the band leader to put that tune within his repertoire.
I call that payola, I'm sorry.
Well, the first radio station when you first ever become a professional disc jockey?
Oh, I was a professional disc jockey when I was in the top rank in Bristol before Radio Caroline. I was thrown out of the Musicians' Union. I was the only guy who was ever thrown out of the MU for playing records when the band had a break. Records were new in dance halls, and the Musicians' Union didn't like them at all. So big union meeting, and I was voted out of the union. Top Rank dancing didn't exactly cover my palm with gold in the summer of 1963 as I moved from Oldham in the north to Bristol in the West Country. £20 a week for singing, playing guitar, and DJing over 8 sessions a week was cheap labour, all right. But life was great. The ballroom scene was changing swiftly. The Beatles were cracking the world, and the music just got better and better. Well, that's your lot, you lucky beggars. That's all from yours truly, your royal ruler, Tony Prince, and my good friend, DJ Woody. See you live on stage. Next time on the History of DJ, the British Musicians Union stand against the DJ. Big bands make way for the Beatles, and we meet Sir Roger Gale, the only pirate DJ to become a Member of Parliament.
Sounds fine, it's Paola!
Sweet 16 goes to church just to see the falls. Laughs and shouts and giggles at every little noise. Turns her face a little every once in a while. Everybody knows she's only putting on the style. Well, putting on the agony, putting on the style. That's what all the young folks are doing all the while. And as I look around me, I sometimes have to smile. Seeing all the young folks putting on the style. Well, the young man in the hot rod car, driving like he's mad. In a pair of yellow gloves, he borrowed from his dad. He makes it go so lively, just to see his girlfriend smile. Everybody knows he's only putting on the style. Well, putting on the agony, putting on the style. Well, that's what all the young folk are doing all the while. And as I look around me, I sometimes have to smile. Seeing all the young folk putting on the style.
poke-a-doo and haw-haw.